We shall be discussing working capital management. Working capital is the amount of cash that a company can safely and conveniently spend in such a way that spending will not affect the financial capacity of the organization. I said that working capital is that amount that a company can safely and conveniently spend in such a way that spending will not affect their financial capacity. Working capital can be derived by subtracting the current liability from the current asset. Working capital can be derived by subtracting the current liability from the current asset. Working capital is important because it is used to pay short-term financial obligations. And the focus of working capital is usually cash and all those other assets that can be easily and quickly converted into cash in the short term. The short term is usually considered as a period not more than 1 year. The management of working capital helps to effectively make use of current assets so that sufficient cash can be available to meet the short-term financial obligations of any organization. In this topic, our focus shall be on cash budgeting and inventory or stock management, which is also the same thing as inventory or stock model. Cash budgeting has to do with preparing a plan, a periodic plan of the income and expenditure of any organization. We shall now go ahead to give a comprehensive example that will show us how income of the organization is planned and how the expenditure of the organization is captured, and then we'll go ahead to prepare a cash budget. To illustrate the cash budgeting, let us now take an example of a company called Unilag PLC, where the details of the following information has been provided. That Unilag PLC produces two products called product X and product Y. The selling price, which is represented by SP for product X, is 15 naira, while the selling price of product Y is 25 naira. The cost price, the cost of purchasing this product by Unilag PLC, is 8 naira for product X and 15 naira for product Y. Now, the information from this place from January to June has been broken down on a monthly basis. This is the quantity of goods bought and sold by Unilag PLC from January, February, March, April, May, and June has been provided. 500 naira, 500 units of product X was bought and sold in January, and 300 units of product Y was bought and sold in January, and so on. Additional information has been given. The additional information that has been given has to do with how the income and expenditures have been collected. In the month of sale or purchase, 60% of the amount sold, 60% of the amount sold is collected immediately, while 25% of the amount sold is collected 1 month after the sales is made. 12% of the amount sold is collected 2 months after the sales is made, while 3% is bad debt that cannot be collected, which is regarded as a loss. For the payments to suppliers, Unilag PLC makes 70% payment of whatever they purchase in the month of purchase. They make 20% of whatever they purchase 1 month after, and they make 10% of whatever they purchase 2 months after. Also, in the month of February, electricity bill of 4,000 was paid by Unilag PLC. Unilag PLC pays salaries of 2,500 per month. They pay other expenses. They make other expenses of 1,000 naira per month. And then in the month of March, a dividend of 10,000 was received by Unilag PLC while they have opening balance of 5,000 naira at the beginning of January. Let us now see how Unilag PLC will prepare a cash budget to cover this information. After preparing that schedule to calculate the amount that was sold per month of both product X and Y and the amount that was purchased per month for both product X and Y, we shall now go ahead to prepare another schedule that shows how this credit sales, or how this sales, how the money for these sales will be recovered, to show how the monies for these sales will be recovered, and we call that receipts from sales. We are told that 60% of the sales made will be collected in the month when that sales is made, while 25% will be collected 1 month after, and 12% will be collected 2 months after, while we have a 3% loss. So for both product X and product Y, in the month of January, the total sales was, for the combination of both product X and Y, the total sales for the month of January was 15,000. Out of this 15,000, we are told that 60% will be collected in the month of sales. That 60% amounts to 9,000. So 9,000 will be collected. The total sales of both product X and Y that was made in the month of January amounts to 15,000. But we are told that 60% of that 15,000 will be collected in the month of sales, which is January, whereas 25% of that 15,000 will be collected the following month, which is February. 25% will be collected in the month of February. That amounts to 3,750. We're also told that 12% will be collected in the month, 2 months after, which that 2 months after happens to be the month of March. So 12% will be collected 2 months after, that happens to be the month of March, while the remaining 3% is lost to bad debt. Then in the month of February, another sales of 15,000 was made, both on the combination of both X and Y. Another sales of 15,000 was made. And then the month of February, 60% will be collected as well. That 60% amounts to 9,000. While the 1 month after February is March, where 25% will be collected. 25% will amount to 3,750. While 2 months after the month of February will be April. 2 months after the month of February will be April, when 1,800, which happens to be 12% of 15,000, will be collected. The remaining 3,000, of course, will be lost. Now for the month of March, a combination of both product S and Y produce a sales of 10,250. So if 60% of that amount is recovered in that month, it means that in the month of March, 6,150, which happens to be 60% of 10,250, is recovered immediately, while 25% will be collected 1 month after. That 1 month after March is April. That amounts to 2,562.5, while 12% will be collected 2 months after, and that 12% amounts to 1,230. And so this is how the collection will be made. Having collected according to schedule, which is 60% in the month of sales, 25% 1 month after, and 12% 2 months after, we have now realized that in the month of January, a total of 9,000 was collected. In the month of February, a total of 12,750 was collected. In the month of March, a total of 11,700 was collected. Tito in the month of April, this is the total. In the month of May, this is the total. In the month of June, this is the total that was collected. Now we shall do the same type of schedule for the payment that will be made by Unilag PLC to its suppliers. We shall do the same type of schedule for the payment that will be made by Unilag PLC to suppliers. We shall do the same type of schedule, but this time indicating the payments that will be made to suppliers. If you check the example, you realize that a total of 8,500 worth of product X and Y was purchased from the suppliers. The total purchase for the month of January was 8,500. And then if 70% of that amount will be paid to supplier in the month of purchase, that will amount to 5,950. Why 20% of that amount will be paid 1 month after? 1 month after January becomes February, that's 1,007. Why 10% will be paid 2 months after? 10% of 8,005 is 850. 2 months after January is the month of March. Again, in the first month of February, a total of 8,750 worth of goods were purchased from suppliers. So if we pay 7% of 8,750 in the month of purchase, which is February, month of purchase this time is February, we'll be paying 6,125. Why 20% of 8,750 will be paid 1 month after? 1 month after February is March. 1,750 will be paid. Why 10%, the remaining 10% will be paid 2 months after? That amounts to 875. This is how payments will be made throughout the months from January to June. By the time all the payments have been made according to the payment plan, this is what the payment schedule will look like. At the end of January, a total of 5,950 would have been paid. At the end of February, a total of 7,825 would have been paid, which is the addition of these two. At the end of March, a total of 6,660 would have been paid, which is the addition of these three. Well, at the end of April, a total of 11,135 would have been paid, which is the addition of these three items. And then a total of 10,670 would have been paid in May, and a total of 9,950 would have been paid by the end of June. Finally, we can now go ahead to prepare the cash budget of Unilag PLC from the preliminary calculations that we have made. To prepare the cash budget, first of all, we start with the receipt. The monies that have been collected. Receipts received from buyers. Received from buyers in the month of January, the total receipt from buyers was 9,000. While in the month of February, the total receipt was 12,750. In the month of March, the total receipt was 11,700. And in the month of April, was 17,862.5. In the month of May, was 17,955. And in the month of June, was 17,225. Now we recall that in the example, we were told that a dividend of 10,000 was paid in the month of March, I think. A dividend of 10,000 was paid in the month of March. So in the month of March, a dividend of 10,000 was collected. So therefore, the total income that the organization received, the total income that the organization received will now be calculated. This is 9,000, right? This is 12,750, this is 21,700, 17,862.5, 17,955, and then 17,225. And then payments. payments made to suppliers as follows. In the month of January, payment of 5,950 was made. 7,825. So these are all the payments that have been paid me to suppliers month by month according to our preliminary calculations. We are also told that electricity of 4,000 was paid in the month of February. Electricity of 4,000 was paid in the month of February. While salaries amount to 2,005 per month. We also have other expenses to be 1,000 per month. So this gives us a total payment our calculations, by adding all this, we have a total payment of 9,450 in the month of January, 15,325 in the month of February, and so on, 10,160 in the month of March, 14,635 in the month of April, 14,170 in the month of May, and then 13,450 in the month of June. So what we have now is to calculate the net. What we now have to do is to calculate the net payment and receipt after determining from our preliminary calculations what the total receipt for each month is and what the total payment for each month is. We shall now determine the net receipt or payment by subtracting the total receipt from the total payment from the total receipt. So we see that in the month of January, it was negative 450 because payment was higher than receipt. The same thing in the month of February, it was negative 2,575 because the payment made in February was higher than the receipt. In the month of March, it was 11,540 because the receipt in the month of March was more than the payment made. In the month of April, it was positive because payment was less than receipt. The same thing in the month of May, it was positive because payment was less than receipt. In the month of June, it was also positive because payment was less than receipt. Having determined the net payment or receipt, remember that in the example, the Unilab PLC had an opening balance of 5,000. So when we bring the opening balance of 5,000, we have a closing balance of 4,550. Then this closing balance at the end of January will be transferred to become the opening balance at the beginning of February. By the time we transfer 4,550 to become the opening balance in January, this negative figure goes off, and then we have a closing balance of 1,975. And then this is also transferred. We shall continue to transfer the closing balance for each month to become the opening balance for the next month, and then add the net receipt or income until we get the final answer, which is 24,302. Thank you so much for watching. I hope it was worthwhile.